Oh, please put that on. Yes. Excellent. Is it Carlos? Carlos?
So, my name is Carlos Aragona, PhD candidate at the University of Catalonia, and today I'm going to talk to you about software design for a specific spacecraft, which is Nansatlet. Nansatlet has evolved from a feasible solution that we explore to an alternative when developing space systems. They have been space for many small companies to universities and research centers. And we have been proven to be suitable platforms for a variety of purposes. Technology demonstration, a variety of Earth observation missions, and other low power space applications. This content, many teams are developing their non-satellite program. Some of them, or quite a lot of them, are developed under a program in university. These tend to be less demanding in terms of accuracy or reliability. That's true. But those already show the clear sign of the ongoing democratization of space, which is basically that everybody can or should be able to build and operate. Are envisioned as one of the key elements in new architecture, such as spacecraft, complex satellite systems like federated satellite systems, or huge kinds of satellites which involve hundreds and hundreds of new operating threats. What some people think, and it's come to find in terms of satellite development, is basically the integration of several components which are transformed into a nanosatellite unit. And in that case, the development process of the software process ultimately needs or requires the engineer to write software which controls the payload. That's critical. That is something that I want to emphasize during the presentation. However, consolidation of this use that area. Less attention has been paid on software-related issues or software design issues. And since, of course, software is more of architectural elements to desired functionalities, and its correctness will definitely affect the functionality of the spacecraft, we think it's really important to start design. The length of software architecture also for nanosatellites. This is something that I would like to address in my presentation. The in four sections, I'll try to be brief. I would like to give you a view of what people is doing, what nanosatellites are really in terms of system characteristics and software features. To begin with, I think it's obvious, but you have to understand that most satellites have no hardware redundancy. Most of them are components, which means that we have barely no radar technology on board. Due to the size and limited computational capability, probably similar to some other missions in large spacecraft. And this thing that I would like to emphasize, and it's the fact that most nanosatellite programs, not only their unit, so to speak, they develop reusable platforms that can hold a variety of space payloads in some even more than one, and which are intended to be reusable from one satellite to another. That's very important in terms of the software design and development. Having different approaches in software, which have to solve in context of reusable platforms have tried to make software easy to modify, to seek, and to upgrade from one generation to the following. Diversity that we can find is huge. There have been universities developing software, and the way they approach the design is really different. Like, for instance, I've shown you here examples, one from California, Pennsylvania State University, which centralized architecture where one on board computer has different modes of operation, where one Alpha 3 mission in 2008, if I remember, is distributed in decentralized one. And I just wanted to point out that the diversity in terms of design is really huge. So now I or comment on what are the critical aspects in terms of design for that could be improved or that have the potential to be included in new. We've got a list with three, we've called them requirements or software requirements, which are robustness, software modulation, scalability, and autonomy. The first one is probably the most obvious one. Since a tablet platform, we have basically box components which have no run logic, and implemented on top of real time operating systems. Most of these sophisticated industry renowned products, but instead they tend to be Linux operating systems like NMI or FreeRTC or even small footprint operating systems like FreeRTC. I think somebody mentioned on that yesterday during the workshop. Although the mission of a mission will last 1 year, we still want to last it at least 1 year. Designing robustness at the architectural level will be great, and that's why we include it in the list of potential requirements. The second one refers to the fact that we have reusable platforms. But what we mean is that the same, let's say, hardware and software architecture will be used to host different things. So what here to design software architecture where we can remove modules which definitely the payload functionality. Or subsystems may have the same basic subsystems like EVA or COMS or attributes to systems. Their board or related can change, although the module will and the requirement that we want to propose here today is autonomy. This is not the quality of software architecture, but instead it's a functionality. The functionality that has been added in previous large space transmissions, and it was very interesting to include that on NASA missions as well. First, because of the limited observability of CubeSat. Not only in LEO orbits, which give us like 10 or 15 passengers, but also they have a very constrained communication channel. And because of that, data that you can download and upload to your CubeSat is really limited, and the capacity or for your ground team to react to errors is diminished because of that. On the other hand, be autonomous and have the capability to reschedule its activities. Autonomous improve the system, the mission quality, and would allow for the user to not to remain in reset state until the next task happens over the ground space. On the other hand, providing autonomy capabilities to spacecraft can also improve the time return of that spacecraft. This is something that has been proven in tax emissions, but it's not something that is new, is that these systems are also suitable or are proven to be suitable in natural environments. Let's say this is the case when the index emission has a similar role by the same system that larger spacecraft emission, the EOS. On the other hand, things like the one I presented before, like installations of spacecraft, or small spacecraft, go and proactively communicate to one another to achieve a global goal, require some sort of autonomy at the unit level. So with these requirements, what I will do now is to provide three guidelines which are aimed for any kind of program, not only the one, and try to address that I have presented. All this robustness through hierarchy. Every year, when I'm talking about the software design, I'm talking about the application layer. So choosing the proper real-time operating system and middleware is critical. I'm not trying to address here in my presentation today. Guidelines try to boost system robustness at a few related architectural levels. We've seen many use-type architectures that or the software architecture is just based on the juxtaposition of modules, which for interact with some specific action. What I have is to base the encapsulation of your modules, of your different parts or components of the architecture, into several levels of abstraction where the top part of the architecture all the critical functions for your mission and all the abstract your mission, like finance machine, viral control, and the like. And if as people from hardware as possible. Fragmentation of components can also happen horizontally, and that's what we want to put, is that when you have this hierarchical ordering of components, you also divide each layer into several modules, which implement part of a, let's say, global spacecraft functionality, like for instance, management, attitude control, communication, etc. The first guideline that we want to propose towards a high level of robustness. Here is always to prevent error prevention from one module to another. If the modules are sufficiently isolated and the let's say relations are implemented through reliable robust communication channels, the propagation of errors in the system is somehow reduced. Everyone is aimed at a way to modernize software at the payload level. What we propose here is since the things that are going to change are mostly for nanosatellite architecture, what better provide interface for any type of payload that you can imagine, and then you could have as part of your architecture to be able to control any kind of future application that your satellite requires. Generic interface could be the one that we propose here, which is based on four different functions for payload modules. A function which we call check to verify that the system is in a correct state before, just to check that everything is okay. Then execute the routine of the failures, whatever they are. Once they have finished those, the function will do the inverse step that the instruction previously did and release on the resource, software resource. It would be to include other functions which we might have the system for failures, which can first deliver instantaneous data, like sensors, we create new data. We can solve cases in which the need for an external trigger to transition from one internal state to the other, or failures or systems for this generation module, which can do or can a one-time action, like for instance, enable a power converter on a certain board. To problematic, we came up with the concept of a one-shot function, which is basically some custom function or set of functions that each payload or the system could implement. Now the third solves the autonomy problem of users and well managers in general. With Faraday, a change of finding that has happened in the spacecraft. What you say here is you have a completely telemetry ground operated operability. To a system which is capable, can do its own activity based on some high level mission goals. But we want to provide the NASA with the capability to intelligently plan the activity, to also robustly execute this plan of action, and to do both of these things based on mission goals, based on the environmental conditions and on some constraints which might be required for security or reliability. To build an autonomous system, the solution that we propose is essentially a very common one. It's essentially to implement three different modules, three different components, which form what is called the autonomy system. A task planner, which is able to allocate resources for a given task, and to do that, and it does that in advance. So it calculates that I am going to do something, and I will reserve some resources, like power, like availability to do so. On the task planner, has generated the plan of action, which needs, as I said, an executive system, which is able to execute this function while at the same time monitor that any of the constraints are not violated. And an element that could be probably optional depending on the mission, which we call task generation engine, which would based on all diagnoses coming from the executive system and more instrument data processing would generate task requests to the task planner. That means a complete loop in terms of the autonomous system of a NASA. I've presented these three requirements and guidelines. I would also like to illustrate those into a software architecture for a huge submission, that we developed in a technical university of Catalonia in Barcelona. One mission is essentially a demonstration mission with the only particularity that it has seven different payloads compacted into a one-minute system, and six of them are managed by a centralized onboard computer. On to the different components or modules of the architecture, but I will try to show how we apply the design criteria into the architecture. First, we have a big one, four different layers, which are actually four different layers of abstraction. You explain the layers in the following like the architecture is actually deployed on top of a Linux based real time system which has Gemini 2.6. And they all have access to shared resources, shared software resources, data resources for logging and housekeeping from the configuration files. They also can generate output based on files, and they can also communicate with each other through keys that are managed by kernel services. So the four layers, we call them, well, these are the layers of the architecture. The last part of the architecture is the one that is on top of the slide. Sorry for that. It's what we call dependent modules. These are actually modules which encapsulate payload and subsystem functionality. You know, we have up to 7 different hardware modules, which are shown here in the right of the slide. Modules implement the same interface that I've shown you in previous slides. You'll be able to manage all of them with from the process manager layer without having to deal with the particularity of the system for payloads. The process manager, as I said, is actually one of the parts of the onboard autonomy system. It's actually the exact executive system which executes all the commands and orders coming from the higher part of the architecture, and which decomposes the plan of action, which is a description of the activities that have to be performed, into a set of sequential routines that are executed per block. Interfacing the hardware-dependent modules, we've designed what we call the system literal, which is basically a command grouper which transparently and securely forward commands and replies from the dependent modules to the process manager. On top of that, system core, which is a higher level controller of the mission, is the one that implements the climate state machine and all the system variables and stage of system, and is the one which encompasses the second part of the autonomous system, which is a guidance. In this case, the elastic priority rate multi-resource that we have in the control. So I want just to summarize the part that have been in the presentation. First, I think, well, it's emphasizes enough that there are some well that the software is the issues in NASA have not focused on solver lately. I mean, this is what we want to push. We want to push not only you guys, but the community out there in the university, in hobbies, and present you these three requirements that I think are critical for next generation nanotablet software, which are modularity oriented to payloads, which are very important, and spacecraft autonomy. With that, the guidance. I want to speak to now answer your questions if you have some, and for your attention.
Are there questions?
You talked about the system which used a patent approach. And of course, the approach that you could easily have taken would be one based on shared memory. I was wondering which one or the other.
Actually, one of the solutions we came up with when designing these software architectures, which try executive autonomy, you know, and because of that, with this system, to and custom protocols to connect these of the architect. Of course, we could have used types of communication. We actually, in fact, we have in some specific cases where processes have to communicate with not real time. But in order to have a transparent layer with which the process manager can communicate with it, to go to that approach instead of any other facility. But that was not a very critical decision. So.
Other questions?
Unified interface for the instrument, but seems to me more like way to have the same way of only modes of the repetition, more just phase of the instrument. Have you thought about unifying when it comes to data exchange?
Well, we haven't unified that because our approach, again, to have a transparent layer which is able to provide communication or communication channel between modules and layers of the architecture, but also between two different modules. So, module which implements the interface also because it also has access to the list of commands that are available in the system data. And our approach to our communication is kind of
other questions?
Yes.
Linux platform, I'm curious how much of the Linux user space to actually use our, for instance, system process monitors, file systems, things like that, or are you really doing a very stripped down minimalist Linux installation and then doing everything yourself and trusting the software?
Using a plain Linux kernel with GMI real time patch. Well, the best part, we actually don't require anything else, like anything else. I mean, we just need the kernel, and all the processes run directly into the kernel territory and that. However, you can mission has installed a distribution, because it was easier for us to access to programs and to bring map. Network file system. But in the architecture from on top of plain involved.
Other questions? Yes.
I mean, the kernel is something that has to be used processes, something that can manage processes, or file system involved. I'm just curious about user state.
User state. So we actually deploy a set of processes that we control. But on the user space, and we take advantage of some of the kernel services that are provided by the GMI kernel.
Wait. The system without redundancy and using cost components, what are the functional features for this?
And I'll give you a quick answer. redundancy at the software level. So we don't have any redundant processing or anything like that, but there's people doing that. Also, replication of data, like bootloader or images. We have that in this design, although we are for next use that
Thank you.